Bonsoir and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Will Straw. I'm the director of the McGill Institute for the Study of Canada, and I'd like to invite you to welcome you all to this year's Seagram lecture, which this year will be in the form of a conversation between Malcolm Gladwell and Eleanor Wachtel about Malcolm Gladwell's latest book, David and Goliath, Underdogs, Misfits, and the Art of Battling Giants. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about the Seagram lecture in a moment, but first I'd like to mention that the McGill Institute for the Study of Canada holds a major annual conference each year, and this year, that is in February 2014, our conference will focus on what we're calling petrocultures. We'll bring together leading figures to discuss and debate oil, energy, and Canada's future. There's a little pamphlet outside that can tell you more about that and tell you how to register and so on. Denise Chong is going to formally introduce Eleanor Wachtel in just a minute, but first I'd like to say a few words about the Seagram lecture itself. The Institute has hosted Seagram lectures since 1996, part of our distinguished lecture series. These have contributed to raising the Institute's profile locally and internationally and helped the Institute in developing networks in Canadian studies and breathing new life into the field. They've enriched the academic life of McGill and added to the connections between McGill and other universities. Some of our Seagram lecturers in the past have included Stephen Clarkson, Roger Chartier, George Elliott Clark, Tina Liu, Gerard Friesen, John Roberts, and so on. I'd now, though, like to invite Denise Chong to introduce Eleanor Wachtel. Denise Chong has done amazing work for several years as the co-chair of the board of the McGill Institute for the Study of Canada, and she's also a distinguished author in her own right, most recently with the book Lives of the Family, Stories of Fate and Circumstance, a work of creative nonfiction. So I'll ask Denise now to come and introduce Eleanor Wachtel.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Some time ago, on behalf of the McGill Institute for the Study of Canada, when I extended an invitation to Malcolm Gladwell, hoping that he would consider being the Seagram lecturer, I managed to wangle his personal email address and sent him an email, and he wrote back, "Well, I'm busy scribbling my new book. Ask me again in a few months." So I thought, wow, I think he's open to the idea. So just to borrow a phrase from Malcolm Gladwell, I thought, well, what would be the tipping point? And I thought, Eleanor Wachtel. Because as an author, Eleanor Wachtel is the pinnacle of a literary conversation. And even as I was writing my most recent book, and I toiled into the night, I would put on CBC Writers and Company and play the same broadcasts over and over and over again. And with each time I heard it, there was a freshness to it. And why? Because Eleanor Wachtel is so engaged, she's got an inquiring mind, and she has so much empathy. So Writers and Company, CBC's Writers and Company, it recently celebrated its 23rd anniversary. Eleanor is not only the host, but the co-founder of it. She also hosts and co-produces Wachtel on the Arts, and she produces Wachtel on the Arts as well. The selections from both those broadcasts are in two different publications, Writers and Company and More Writers and Company. Well, Eleanor Wachtel is an author herself. She's published Original Minds, about extraordinary writers from the fields of art, science, economics, anthropology, and social policy, a series inspired by men and women who have made a difference in the way we understand the world. She's received many, many honors, including 8 honorary degrees, and she's a member of the Order of Canada. And she's coming home. She was born and raised in Montreal. She studied English literature at McGill, and on behalf of the co-chair, my co-chair, Lily de Grandpre, and the board, I can tell you how honored and proud we are that Eleanor Wachtel is also a member of the board of the McGill Institute for the Study of Canada. So, Eleanor, can we welcome you to the stage?
Thank you very much. It's an honor for me to be here. And slightly frightening because I used to sit in the very back of this class for almost all my first year courses were in this room. And sometimes they even managed to take attendance, even if you were sitting in the very back of the classroom. Anyway, Malcolm Gladwell is a phenomenon, frequently described as one of the most brilliant and influential writers of his generation because of how he's able to explore and capture social trends and behavior in ways that define the age. New York Magazine headlined their profile about him, "Geek Pop Star." Gladwell forages in academia for illuminating studies in social science, psychology, economics, anything that he can relate to and make connections with to develop his ideas. Then he fleshes it out with anecdote or pocket biographies. He writes with a kind of clarity that makes you think, of course, but also with curiosity and surprise so that even the counterintuitive makes sense. Malcolm Gladwell was born in London. His father's English, his mother Jamaican, but he grew up in small town Ontario in Elmira. He studied at the University of Toronto and then moved to the United States as a journalist. He was with the Washington Post for 9 years, and then in 1996 he became a staff writer at the New Yorker magazine. And it's from that perch that he developed his style and wide-ranging but unique approach. So it's my great pleasure to welcome Malcolm Gladwell.
Thank you.
Closer.
How's that? This? This?
And I should, sorry.
Welcome.
Yeah.
Do we get some sound? How's that?
Yeah, so this isn't your first time in Montreal.
No, I have been here many times. This is maybe 6 or 7. I'm past the tourist phase.
You're in what, the visitor phase?
I'm in the regretful leaver phase.
Oh, that's a good phase to be. Periodically during their conversation, I will say something like Malcolm Gladwell, and it's not to remind everyone who I'm talking to, but because the program is being recorded for broadcast on Writers and Company, and will, in case you want to hear your laughter again, it's a week from Sunday. At 3 o'clock, that's November the 24th. In your book, Outliers, you wrote about people whose success came in part from advantages in their environments. For instance, Bill Gates, who had access to computers as a young student. What made you want to come at this question from the other side, from people who face what appear to be disadvantages?
Because... other than a kind of baseline level of self-loathing, which makes me want to contradict myself whenever possible. Because in that book, the story that was always... I began Outliers with the chapter about Jewish lawyers in New York and their unlikely rise to prominence. And what was interesting with that story, and I never really properly resolved that issue in Outliers, what's interesting with that story is that everything that proved ultimately advantageous for this group of, they were all men who went into the legal profession in the 50s and 60s, grew out of disadvantage, out of obstacles. It was because they were locked out of the waspy downtown law firms, and it was because mergers and acquisitions was considered to be, in the 50s and 60s, too dirty for the WASPs to do, that all of these young Jewish lawyers were shunted into this secondary world. They started these little firms, and they were did all this M&A stuff. And then, lo and behold, M&A becomes, mergers and acquisitions becomes the most lucrative and most prominent and most important part of corporate law within 20 years. And the very fact that they had been excluded and forced to do this ends up being advantageous. So it was this weird case that had they never been discriminated against, they would never have come to dominate the legal profession. So there was a case where all the other stories in Outliers are about advantages that prove advantageous, except for the Jewish lawyers. And I puzzled about this, and I thought, you know, maybe I should just explore that paradox for a moment. And maybe I need to expand my palette of explanations. And that's, so I was, it grows out of that, that little unresolved element in Outliers.
Well, near the beginning of David and Goliath, you say one motivation for this book was to show how the fact of facing overwhelming odds produces greatness and beauty. Mm-hmm. When did you first see evidence of that in the world?
When? Well, in retrospect, all the time. But it's an odd thought to... It takes a long time. I suppose you have to be... You have to have reached a certain age. And here I'm making myself sound like an old man, which I sort of am. But it takes a long time to sort of understand that point, you know, because the thing about beauty and greatness coming from adversity is that it's not obvious in the moment. It's only obvious in retrospect. So, for example, when I have a chapter on all these dyslexics who have had very successful careers. And when they would describe their childhood, they would describe miserable childhoods. I mean, they were incapable of doing what you're supposed to do as a child, read. They were often, delinquent, or they were kicked out of schools, or they were thought of as being, they were put in the special class. I mean, there was all kinds of ways in which they're, and they look back, some of these grown men who've had extraordinarily successful careers would look back on their childhood and just say it was a nightmare, right? But then from the advantage of the age of 50 or 55 or 60, they would say, but I'm grateful for it. So it takes a long time to understand the meaning of certain things you go through in life. In the story that I end the book with about the Huguenots in France, and maybe we'll come back to this, but I'll just briefly say, the Huguenots only grasped during the Second World War the meaning of the persecution they suffered in the 18th century, in the 19th century. It takes 150 years for them to understand why it was important that they weathered that storm. Right? So it's a kind of...
I understand the greatness, it's the beauty, I find, unless it's a very refined sense of beauty.
Is it beautiful? Well, I suppose I do find it's an odd. I suppose it's an odd definition of beauty. But the chapter in the book about is a chapter in the book about Emil Freireich, who's this oncologist who is one of the most important figures in the curing of childhood leukemia, and he has a Dickensian childhood, and he manages a truly horrific childhood, and he's permanently damaged as a result. But he manages to find in the trauma of his childhood a series of things that make his assault on childhood leukemia possible. And I find that incredibly beautiful. Many other things as well, but in talking, he's now an old man. He's now in his 80s. And he's still this kind of damaged, extraordinary damaged, irrepressible, disagreeable, brilliant man. But in talking to him, I was so kind of moved by talking to him at how he had managed to look through this most dreadful of childhoods and extract a series of pearls. That's beautiful. There's no other word for it, right? To sort of, to have the courage and the strength to see little points of light in all that darkness. So that's what I mean by beauty.
We're going to come back to some of those stories. Mm-hmm. How did you decide on the Old Testament story of David and Goliath as the point of departure for your new book?
Well, only at the very end of the book, because I had, you know, I was aware of the, I wanted to call the book David and Goliath because I went on Amazon and realized that no one had ever written a book called David and Goliath, which struck me as, I was like, that cannot be possible. It's been 3,000 years. You know, but no one had. So I thought, you know, this is a kind of, if I don't do it, someone, you know,
someone's
going to snap it up, at least in the next 1,000 years or so. So I better move quickly. So you're, once you decide to call your book David and Goliath, you're pretty much locked in. You've got to talk about that story. But I didn't, I wasn't interested in the story. I was just going to use it as a metaphor, you know, it's the great metaphor for, and I was just going to refer to it metaphorically. And then at the very end of writing the book, I thought, well, I should really go and read some of the literature around it. And I started to run across all of these fascinating articles, almost all written by Israelis, for reasons I don't really understand. Moshe Dayan writes about the great Israeli general, architect of the Six-Day War, writes this really brilliant essay about David and Goliath, reinterpreting David and Goliath. Then I had this long chat with this guy named Eitan Hirsch, who's a ballistics expert with the Israeli Defense Force, who presents a paper at the International Ballistics Society, yes, such a thing exists, and in which he does the math on David's sling in a way that was so, for a geek such as myself, so deeply pleasing that someone, so I started this email correspondence with him, and he's, you know, it's just fabulous that he has devoted this huge chunk of time and energy to kind of decoding just how fast was the rock, you know, going. What damage could the rock do based on contemporary analysis of cadavers? What kind of rock was it? It was barium sulfate. That's twice as heavy as normal rocks. Like, he had, like, gone through this in chapter and verse.
He was like a gunshot by the time he was finished.
He was the one who kind of concludes that the rock has the stopping power of a .45 caliber handgun. But I guess if you're a ballistics expert and you are committed to presenting papers at the International Ballistics Society, how much do you want to go, by the way, to that conference? Ever since I read about that, it's like, at some point in my life, I'd like to go to the International Ballistics Society conference and just see, because if they're doing papers on David and Goliath, that's the only paper I know about. What else are they doing papers on? I mean, anyway, so he was very interesting. And then there was all the endocrinologists. And it turns out the endocrinologists had been deeply interested in Goliath for a long time, since the early 60s. And once I understood that whenever the endocrinologists have joined in, you know you're on to something, right? So I began to read all this weird stuff, and I thought, oh, now I can. So then the last chapter I wrote in the book was what is now the first chapter. I went back and realized I could retell the whole story of David and Goliath based on all of this contemporary, fascinating, and kind of, on one level, hilarious speculation. So that was late.
Because the metaphorical import of the story was simply, you know, little guy defeats unlikely victory of little guy over huge guy, right?
Yeah.
And then the way you retell it is,
Eitan Hirsch points out that the sling is a devastating weapon. It's
not a slingshot, it's something that's
a sling. You zip it around your head at 6 revolutions per second, and then you release the rock, and it is one of the deadliest weapons in ancient times. There's no way Goliath, and also these guys were insanely accurate if you were an expert with it. Goliath, if David's 50 yards away from Goliath, he absolutely can find the spot between his eyes, and he will absolutely kill him with that rock. And then the endocrinologists are the ones who point out that Goliath probably has acromegaly, which is
the reason he's such a giant is because he has a pituitary
he's
problem.
He's got a tumor on his pituitary gland, which causes his giantism. Andre the Giant had acromegaly, right? So Goliath and Andre the Giant are sort of in the same category. And acromegaly has a side effect, which it very often, the tumor on your pituitary gland, which causes overproduction of human growth hormone, accounting for your size, also grows to the point where it begins to constrict your optic nerves, which means you have restricted sight. Goliath is half blind. And once you realize that, the story starts to make sense because he's led onto the valley floor by an attendant, which is crazy. Why is he being led by the hand, this mighty warrior? And why does it take him so long to figure out what David is up to? David is coming down from the ridge, dressed in his shepherd's outfit, with no sword, right? And he's supposed to be having a sword fight. Now, if I'm Goliath, I look up and I see a guy coming towards me without a sword, and I think, this is not as it should be, right? I would complain. I would do, you know. Goliath does none of that. He sits there like a lump on a log, and finally, you know, just sort of randomly yelling out insults toward David, right? And then he finally sees him, and he doesn't even put two and two together. And the speculation of the endocrinologist is he just doesn't see him. He just sees a blurry figure. And he thinks, well, he keeps saying, come to me. Goliath repeats that twice, come to me. And if one way is that that's a taunt, come to me. The other is, it's plaintive and pathetic. Come to me. I can't see. Where are you? Come to me. Right?
So, okay, but why do you think these details got left out? I mean, does it make a better story to see David as the underdog?
Is it a better story? It depends. I think it's a better story to realize that David has so beautifully turned the tables. And I think it's a better story to understand that a shepherd boy who has the Spirit of the Lord in his heart, a devastating weapon in his hand, and is up against a big, lumbering, half-blind giant is not an underdog. That, to me, is a great story. I think we've told it the other way because we have a romantic attachment, I think, to exaggerating the plight of the underdog. Right? This sort of, maybe it's more pleasing on one level, on one narrative level, to imagine that when the underdog wins, it was an impossible, you know, bolt from the blue. It was a, you know, one in a million shot. But in fact, underdogs don't win once every million times. They win tons of times. I mean,
but we have such enthusiasm, such sympathy for the underdog. I mean, the Oprah show is predicated on overcoming adversity and against great odds. You know, there's.
You know, I have a, long before I wrote this book, I had very complicated feelings about, should I give you my underdog theory? Why I never cheered for the underdog when I was young.
Yes.
It was because in the 1972 Olympics, Dwight Stones was the overwhelming favorite to win the high jump. If you remember, 76 Olympics, here in Montreal. Dwight Stones is supposed to win. I was a big track and field fan. He was far and away the finest high jumper of his day. He comes to Montreal, and remember, it rained, right? And the top wasn't finished because of because of Drapeau, right? He hadn't finished the long story of, I mean...
Yeah, we won't even go there.
Of mayors not doing what they're supposed to do. And let's not even start on that particular... No. So the top's not done. It's raining. Dwight Stones has this very intricate way of doing the high jump. And because he's slipping, he doesn't win. He comes in third. And here I am, whatever I was, 10 years old, sitting in Elmira, watching this, and it broke my heart. Because I realized that... By the way, this has nothing to do with my book, but just sidebar. I realized that when the favorite loses, he or she experiences far more emotional distress than when the underdog loses. The underdog expects to lose. The favorite expects to win. When the favorite loses, they're crushed. When the underdog loses, they're like, well, I thought I was going to lose. The truly human and empathetic position is to cheer for the favorite, right? If your goal is to align your emotions with those who are suffering, you should always cheer for the favorite. That was my take home from the 1976 Olympics. So, whenever people say, I have a romantic attachment to cheer for the underdog, I think you're cold and callous.
One of the things, one place that you don't go with the David and Goliath story, I mean, you say that it should surprise us to discover that In fact, David was, if you were to lay odds, was the odds-on favorite to win in that particular battle, and that should surprise us. But given, for instance, the American experience in Vietnam, in Afghanistan, in Iraq, it shouldn't surprise us at all.
No, it shouldn't at all. In fact, at one point in the book, I give the numbers. So this political scientist, Ivan Arrington Toft, has done, went back and looked at several hundred battles going over several hundred years where there was, where one side was at least 10 times larger than the other, and asked the question, in those instances, lopsided battles, how often does the weaker party win? And the answer is, if I'm remembering correctly, about 30% of the time. But when the weaker party fights unconventionally, they win 60-some-odd percent of the time. So, in other words, Canada, one-tenth the size of the United States, if the U.S. were to attack Canada, and if Canada were to fight a guerrilla war in response, we would be the odds-on favorite, right? Now, that is mind-blowing. Nobody would put money on us, would they? But we would be, if you just look at the historical record, and by the way, America was 10,000 times the size of Vietnam and lost that one, and is even bigger than Afghanistan and will probably lose that one. So it's like not as if there aren't ample, as you say, ample precedents for this. But we continue to be surprised every time out. Why? It doesn't make any sense, right? This is a lesson that seems to be almost impossible for us to learn.
Do you think Canada is the underdog?
In general? Well, compared to what? Compared to the
United States. Well, compared to the United States, that's been our...
That's the relevant... I think so. I mean, why wouldn't we be? I mean, we have all kinds of underdog traits. We're audacious and plucky.
Speak for yourself. Malcolm Gladwell, not long ago, a piece of yours appeared in the New Yorker magazine that challenged our idea of fair play in sports, and including cycling and baseball. Mm-hmm. What did you want readers to think about in that piece?
Well, I wanted, first of all, that piece was an act of, every now and again, as a writer, one gets a little bored. And you want to sort of stir the pot. So I was sort of bored this summer, and so I wrote this piece, which is a... I should say a deliberate provocation and ought to be read as such. Basically, the argument was, my gut instinct as a sports fan is that I don't want sports figures to use drugs. But I'm also aware that the arguments that I, as a sports fan, use against drugs are terrible. They're the lamest arguments known to man. So we have two examples, Alex Rodriguez and Lance Armstrong. The thing about Lance Armstrong and the other cyclists who use drugs that I can't figure out what my response is that they doped in order to train harder. Lance, the reason you dope if you're a cyclist is that if you don't dope, over the course of an incredibly strenuous race, like the Tour de France, or an incredibly strenuous workout regimen, your endurance declines, right? Your hematocrit, the amount of red blood that's in your body, falls. And so you have to train less. You have to rein in your effort in order to compensate for your body's falling strength. So you use EPO so you can continue to train as hard as you want to train.
EPO being?
Yeah, erythropoietin, the drug that boosts your red blood cells. So Lance Armstrong, it's one thing to denounce cheaters if they are cheating in order to take a shortcut. The reason we don't want people cheating on tests is because they cheat in order to not do the work. Lance's cheating is the opposite. He is the kid who wants to do extra homework, right? Not the kid who doesn't want to do his homework. So I feel weird about denouncing a man for wanting to do his homework, right? I don't know how. Now, I don't want him to use drugs. On the other hand, I've never in my life been in a situation where I tell someone, no, you can't work harder. Then there's Alex Rodriguez.
Well, also you compare Lance Armstrong to this Finnish skier who had this weird condition so that he naturally produced extra red blood cells, which enabled him to win six medals or something like that.
We're also in this weird position. Lance was trying to do through artificial means what other people have through
some
natural
quirk
means,
right?
Now, I also have a difficulty with that. Isn't the whole point of living in the modern world that we are allowed to use outside technologies to level the playing field? If my nose is too large, and you have a very beautiful nose, it's perfectly legitimate for me to go to a surgeon to make my nose better. Why should I live with a big nose? That's fine. Well, so Lance says, I wasn't born with the same natural endurance as other people, so I want to use drugs to get to their level. Is that wrong? I don't know. I mean, part of me thinks it is, but I don't have a very good reason for saying that. He just wants to level the playing field on one level, on one sense. But the Alex Rodriguez argument is more interesting, and that is, in baseball, if you're a pitcher and you tear your ulnar collateral ligament in your elbow, you are allowed, not even allowed, you are encouraged to go and find a tendon from either a cadaver or another part of your body and bionically attach it to your elbow, improving the performance characteristics of your elbow considerably, extending your playing career and allowing yourself, under some circumstances, to throw the ball harder than you could before, right? If you're Alex Rodriguez, however, and you're injured, and you want to take a naturally occurring hormone available by prescription anywhere in the world, that's against the rules. Now, if I'm Alex Rodriguez, I look at the picture and I say, you just went through this extraordinary surgical procedure which made you into a different person, right? Gave you a bionic elbow, and I can't take testosterone? Are you kidding me? Why is there one set of rules for pitchers and one set of rules for hitters? Resolve that. If you can resolve that problem, then I will say, all right, then I'll agree with you. But I can't resolve it. I don't understand why that's not hypocrisy. And if I'm A-Rod, I think it's outrageous. I would be hopping up and down at the hypocrisy of that. And of the, you know, baseball, like many sports, the problem with sports is that they are run by people who, for a number of reasons, are reluctant to think deeply about the kind of philosophical status of their sport. So now you can think about all kinds of reasons why. A very good example of this is right now, this totally hilarious controversy is going on in the National Football League, where a player, Richie Incognito, by the way, the greatest name in ever.
It's like, who's on first? So tell us his real name.
An offensive lineman for the Miami Dolphins has been suspended from the game for essentially saying mean things to one of his teammates. Now, this is a guy whose job it is to do bodily harm to other people, to smash his head repeatedly against them, and with the result that some of them will die prematurely. But what is it that we are upset about? That he said mean things to him. It's like unbelievable. Does it ever occur to them that this is, you know, that there is some sort of massive inconsistency between... Anyway, I think that the solution to this is that large groups of philosophers should be extracted by helicopter from universities such as McGill and flown to the site of major NFL and baseball franchises and just asked to resolve these contradictions because they need some help.
So that's one of your more mischievous pieces. One of the theories that you put forward in David and Goliath is something you call the big fish in a small pond.
Yes.
And you give an example of the disappointment that a promising young student experienced when she went to Brown University to study science. This is Brown, Providence, Rhode Island, terrific school. Why did choosing an elite school backfire for her?
So this is this really interesting argument. So it begins with the observation that in North America, we produce an insufficient number of science and math and engineering graduates. Why do we do that? Why do we have too few? Well, the answer is that an overwhelming number of students who sign up in their first year of university in those courses drop out. Something like 50% of the students drop out. Next question is, who drops out? Well, one explanation would be, oh, the kids who drop out are the kids who are simply not smart enough to handle the course load. Well, if you look at the data, you discover that's not true. The kids who drop out are, instead, simply the students who are in the bottom half of their class at whatever caliber of institution they attend. In other words, and this leads us into this time-honored observation called relative deprivation, which is when we make judgments about how good we are at something, we compare ourselves not to the universe, but to those who are in our immediate surroundings. So when you're a student and you decide, am I a good student? Am I capable of mastering a subject? You don't compare yourself to all students in the world taking math or science. You compare yourself to the students in your classroom studying math and science. So this, what this means is, if you're a student and you go to an elite school, you could have an IQ of 150. But if you fall into the bottom half of your class at MIT or Brown or Harvard or McGill, you can wrongly reach the conclusion you're not any good. And this is what's happening. The bottom half of the science class at Harvard drops out. Why? Because they think they can't do math, which is ridiculous, right? But it's not ridiculous if you're in the context of that classroom and you observe that two-thirds of the class is answering questions and you can't answer them. So that same student, if they went to a less elite school, would be in the top half of their class and feel really smart and not drop out, right? So I tell that chapter from the standpoint of a very, very brilliant young woman who's top of her class in high school, has who is more than intellectually capable of handling whatever you throw at her. But she makes the mistake of going to Brown, an exceedingly elite school, and sits in the chemistry in organic chemistry class and convinces herself, because she's surrounded by insanely brilliant people, that she can't do science and drops out. And that's a function of the school she chose.
Not only brilliant, but very competitive, too.
Very competitive, yeah. That's a function not of her own abilities, but of the school she chose. And so the argument of that chapter is there are unexpected drawbacks to elite institutions. They cause us to draw erroneous conclusions about our own abilities. And she realized in retrospect that had she wanted to get a science degree, which is just about the most valuable thing you can get these days, she should have gone to a less elite school. But no one told her that. No one alerted her to the fact that there was a downside to this supposedly prestigious and...
But if you can manage to hang on, I mean, isn't there a prestige factor from graduating from an Ivy League school, or contacts you make, or the even prospective employers don't necessarily pay... this is a Harvard grad, this is a MIT grad, they don't necessarily even look at your grades that closely.
Yeah.
I guess the big if is you have to hang in.
So it's important to understand then that going to an elite institution is a high-risk proposition, that if you manage to succeed and persist and get your science degree, it is possible your science degree will be worth more than a science degree acquired from a lesser institution. Although I will say that when economists attempt to try and measure the value of a degree from an elite institution as opposed to one from a less elite institution, they can't find the difference, or they find it very difficult to find the difference. So it's really unclear but let's stipulate for a moment that it does exist. But you have to weigh that against the fact that you are less likely to get your degree in the first place, right? So when it comes to a science degree is, in today's economy, or a math degree or an engineering degree, is of such extraordinary value that I think the trade-off strongly argues in favor of going to a place that maximizes your chance of graduating, not a place that maximizes the prestige factor of your diploma.
Now, you list your own alma mater, the University of Toronto, to illustrate a more genial, as you put it, mediocre environment. Now, obviously, had you gone to McGill,
now, wait a minute. First of all, I talk about the UT, tongue very firmly planted in cheek, but also that was a discussion strictly about the rankings of the PhD programs in economics.
You have a chart, and it's near the bottom.
Yes, it is near the bottom. That is possibly the only respect in which my alma mater is not an elite institution. So in every other way, U of T
you know.
Well, you went to school with Jim Balsillie and Nigel Wright. I mean, they were your
They were on my hall. Yes, they were.
Did they prove the point or did not?
Well, I don't know. That's a much longer story, isn't it? They're both exceedingly successful people. Yeah. There's no. You can't judge both those. Those are two very, 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 very brilliant people. You can't. My point in that chapter is you cannot judge the value of an elite institution by focusing on those, entirely focusing on those in the 95th percentile, right? You got to look at the full range.
Spectrum, yeah.
Those two, Jim and Nigel, were 95th percentile students. They're not. Now, I was in the 95th percentile student.
I'm sorry, you were?
I was not. Oh,
you
no,
were
no.
Not.
I was. No. God is.
Well, you run into fewer problems than they have.
Well, I didn't. I mean, I didn't do anything nearly as bold as they did. Do you know what I mean? I don't think it's. Both of them have accomplished extraordinary things. They, I don't think you can. If you're going to play at that level, you have to accept the fact that there will be ups and downs. I've played it safe in my life. Neither of those guys played it safe. They did something extraordinary.
Malcolm Gladwell, although it seems counterintuitive, something that you specialize in, you talk about desirable difficulty. What is that?
So I love this phrase. And it's one of the ones that attracted me when I ran across this literature. It sort of fits so perfectly in what I was interested in. This is an idea that's a husband and wife psychologist team at UCLA called the Bjorks, who have written a lot about learning. They're really interested in learning. And our conventional idea about learning is that if I make the task of learning easier, then your performance will improve. If I give you if I ask you to learn physics with a really well-written textbook, you'll learn physics better than if I give you some dense textbook translated from the German, right? But they say that's true, but there are exceptions. There are also instances where when I make the learning task harder, you'll do better. And they pointed all these really interesting exceptions. So that what they argue is there are circumstances where if I make the task of learning harder, you will respond by concentrating more, by going back over the material many times, by doing all kinds of things which will ultimately prove advantageous. And so I give this example of research in that field, which did this really clever thing with fonts, that if you make someone solve a puzzle and you make the font really hard to read, they'll do a better job of solving the puzzle than if the font is easy to read.
But they have to be very highly motivated.
Yes, yes. Well, when you're doing a puzzle, yeah, these are students who know they're taking an intelligence test, so presumably that's motivational if you think that you're... But the idea is that when the font is hard to read, you concentrate. You're forced to maybe read it three times as opposed to jumping to a conclusion. So that's a lovely notion, that idea that you can divide difficulties into two categories, those that are real difficulties and those that are desirable difficulties. And so that got me thinking about, that leads into the chapter on dyslexia, because it seems clear that for some, not a large number, but some portion of dyslexics, their disability is a desirable difficulty. And that raises this really interesting question of why. How is it that the same significant neurological disorder can be undesirable to some and desirable to others?
But desirable, even as you say it, I feel it has to be in italics or in quotation marks or something, because as you alluded to earlier, it can be so painful,
it can be painful
and miserable for the great majority of people who experience it, and only some of them turn it into a desirable difficulty. And as you acknowledge yourself, so many suffer with it. I mean, we even quote prison statistics and things like that. So, I mean, one example you give is Gary Kahn. I maybe want to tell his story because it's
Gary Kahn,
a beautiful illustration of the desirable difficulty.
Yeah. So he's a young kid growing up in Cleveland, and he has severe problems reading. He's dyslexic, although no one, at the time when he's growing up, dyslexia is not commonly diagnosed and
kids, and so they just think he's slow. And as many kids do in those situations, he responds to his problem in schools by trying to hide it, by acting out. And so he's basically a delinquent. He gets kicked out of schools. Everyone thinks he's just a problem child. His mother doesn't think he's ever going to graduate from high school. And finally, he kind of comes under the wing of a very, 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 very devoted teacher when he's in his early teens. He scrapes through high school. He goes to college, scrapes through college, still can barely read, gets a job selling like aluminum siding or something, and one day goes down to Wall Street, and he's really fascinated by trading. And he tries to get on the trading floor and can't. And he spies a guy coming out of the floor, and he says, he kind of talks his way into taking a cab with him. Turns out the guy runs a trading company, is looking for someone to trade options, and Gary Cohn says, I can trade options, which he can't, he has no idea what they are. And he just sort of gambles. Anyway, the upshot is, he shows up the next week, gets a job trading options, does really well, and now he's the president of Goldman Sachs. And the whole thing, as he describes that, his whole point is that learning to cope with this overwhelming difficulty taught him a series of skills and a series of lessons and strategies he would never have learned. It taught him how to be audacious, and it taught him not to fear failure. His whole childhood was a series of extraordinary failures. So why would most of us not do what he did in that instance, which is go up to a stranger, talk your way into the cab, and then pretend to be something that you were not, and risk being exposed, humiliated, whatever? We wouldn't do that because we would be genuinely concerned about the consequences, right? I don't want to be humiliated. I'm not going to put myself out there like that. I'm not going to pretend to be someone I'm not. His point was, I spent my entire childhood pretending to be someone I'm not, being humiliated, and failing. What's one more failure, right? And he said, he points out, it's really interesting. He's like, that's a hugely important thing.
He credits his dyslexia.
Yeah, he says, I am where I am today because of my dyslexia, because I was so hardened and so emboldened in those kinds of situations because I had nothing to lose. Right? He's selling aluminum siding. His mother, when he graduates from high school, is so overwhelmed that he's managed to do this that she's in tears through the entire ceremony. When the bar is that low, right? When mom is just happy that she made it out of high school, right? Weirdly, that's, for him anyway, he interpreted that as being liberating. And so I got versions, I interviewed many, many more of these successful dyslexics than I ended up putting in the book, just because I got hooked on these stories.
And do they follow that pattern?
All of them are versions of that. So the Hollywood producer Brian Grazer, who I had known for years, I never knew he was dyslexic. I was telling him about this. He goes, oh, I'm dyslexic. And he tells me his story. And he's same story. Total nightmarish school years. Complete failure. Kids, and he would do all these things to try and hide his... And his response was, he would fail every test, of course. But his whole thing was that he would go to the teacher after the test was over and talk his way from a D to a C. Right? And he starts doing this in sort of grade 2. And by the time I got to high school, he's like, I was really, really good at it. And then he gets to college and he's a pro. And then what does he do? He becomes a producer. Well, of course he does, right? He's now the greatest negotiator of all time. So he's had 20 years of experience negotiating before. And he starts out in Hollywood and he gets a job pushing a cart around. He's a delivery boy in a studio. And he talks the head of the division he's working in into giving him an office. He's at Warner Brothers. He's 22 years old. So he gets an office now, and he does his job really quickly. And he starts calling other people in Hollywood and says, Brian Grazer here from Warner Brothers. Of course, he's Brian Grazer in the mailroom. But he neglects to mention the mailroom part. He just says, he's not lying. It's true he's at Warner Brothers. But his point is that that's what he was doing his whole life, was talking his way out of a jam, right? And we wouldn't do that because when have we ever done that if we've been a good student our whole life? But him, he's been practicing and practicing and practicing, and he's really good at it. And there's versions, you know, they all... I must have interviewed at least two dozen of these successful... Because there's so many of these successful sex... And they, you find them everywhere. They all hilariously, almost all of them, cheat. I didn't put that in the book. But
well, it comes out in your stories. I mean, it's obvious that...
Yeah, I left out the great cheating stories.
Oh, what's the great cheating one?
Well, no. They all have them.
Oh, I see. The really story, extreme, the most egregious cheating side of the...
It was too hard to explain.
Which one?
But there was one fabulous woman who's one of the top real estate agents in New York, which is saying something, right?
Well, it's saying something about cheating.
No. No, she's just very successful. She makes a lot of money. And so she's severely dyslexic, and she was telling me about how she made it through school, and her cheating strategies were so high-end. I mean, because if you think about it, normal people, when they cheat, so you're a sort of standard cheater. You didn't study for the math test because you were, whatever, partying. So you do some shortcut, and you have to get through. It's like a one-off, right? And you just have to, it's not a big deal if you fail it, whatever. She has to cheat all the time because she just can't do anything that she's been required to do. So cheating has to be sustainable for her. And so she can't get caught, because if she gets caught, then, you know. So it has to be a replicable, sustainable, it's like, she's like the green version of cheating. It's to be local. So she was describing this whole thing where she had all these strategies. Her whole thing was she could walk into a classroom very, very early on, and she would have to size up two things immediately. One, who is the smartest kid in the class? So that's the one I have to cheat off, right? And two, not just the smart, but also then she would separately size up who are the most oblivious kids in the class. So they have to be people who don't realize I'm reading over their shoulder. And then she would look for the overlap between oblivious and smart, and that was who she would target. And so she would try and sit next to the most oblivious smart kid. Now, if from the age of whatever, 7 and 8, you've been forced every time there's a test to size up a whole room full of kids and figure out who the smart oblivious one is, you get really good at reading people. Now, what is being a real estate broker? It's about reading people. It's being able to meet a stranger and instantly know, boom, this is what they want. Because, of course, in real estate, if you're a real estate broker, the great, interesting thing about real estate brokers, and I've often wanted to write about them, because it's actually an incredibly interesting profession. The thing that people say they want in a house is never what they actually want, right? So the really great brokers are the ones who listen to what you say you want and then figure out the difference between that and your true desire. So she has been doing that whole thing her whole life, right? Reading the one step below the... And so it makes sense that she would be brilliant at that. But she would say, without my dyslexia, there's no way I could have done this. But she will simultaneously say, my childhood was a nightmare. I mean, it was, I never stopped worrying because I was always on the brink of discovery, essentially.
So what distinguishes those who turn their difficulties into desirable difficulties and those who end up, just as a shorthand, in jail?
Yeah.
Because, I mean, you mentioned that, you know, a disproportionately high number of dyslexics, and you give the other example from your oncologist who was very successful in curing childhood leukemia, who lost a parent early. So there's other examples of people who lost a parent when they were young who have extraordinary success. So that's a desirable difficulty. And then so many who end up...
Yeah.
Losing. So what distinguishes one from the other? How do you know which way a person is going to go?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question. I don't know whether we have a good answer to that. But one way is, so we have the two things I talk about, these two very interesting case studies, dyslexia and parental loss. And they're both similar in the sense that we see among cohorts of very successful people disproportionate rates of those two things. So if you look at entrepreneurs, you will see an elevated incidence of dyslexia among very successful entrepreneurs. You look at British, others have,
British prime ministers and American presidents as a group have suffered parental a loss of one parent, one or two parents during childhood at rates way higher than the general population. In both those instances, we have people who have been dealt a very traumatic blow and have, as a result of that blow, gotten stronger and learned things they would not otherwise have learned. But we also, in those two instances, know that if you look among the ranks of the depressed, the incarcerated, the whatever, life's failures, or you will see disproportionate numbers of people with both dyslexia and parental loss. So it's bimodal. You go in one of two directions. Either it harms you or it helps you. So what's the difference? Well, clearly there are some obvious ones. Maybe the successful dyslexics are also people who are highly intelligent. That's one possibility. The other thing that I noticed in all of my discussions with all these dyslexics was that in every case, they had at least one family member who never lost faith in them. That was really striking. Gary Cohen has a grandfather who always thought he was not just normal, always thought he was smart, because Gary Cohen would, his family had a plumbing supply business, and he would go to the warehouse where his grandfather worked, and he would help his grandfather after school as a kid. And he could keep the entire inventory in his head because he couldn't read, so he couldn't, wasn't like he could look at the, he would just keep it in his head. And his grandfather would see this and would say, even as everyone else was calling Gary slow and
delinquent,
oh, yeah. His grandfather always said, oh, no, this kid's brilliant. He's got it all in his head. So he had that. And I found that pattern in many of them I talked to, these that they all had one person. And maybe that's crucial, right? So maybe you start to add up. Maybe it is that it's okay to have this drawback and no other. Maybe what sinks people is when they have two or three or four disadvantages, and that's too much. If you are of average intelligence and you come from a shattered family life and you go to a terrible school and you have dyslexia, that's too much. But maybe if I take away two of those other disabilities, then you could turn it into a desirable one. I don't know. It's an interesting question.
Malcolm Gladwell with me at the Seagram Lecture of the McGill Institute for the Studies of... Malcolm Gladwell with me at the Seagram Lecture of the McGill Institute for the Study of Canada in Montreal. He's my guest on Writers and Company on CBC Radio 1, on Sirius Satellite XM, and around the world on cbc.ca. I'm Eleanor Wachtel. Malcolm Gladwell, is the theme of advantage and disadvantage more resonant now than it was, say, a generation or two ago?
Yes, if only because... in the 1950s, I speak for the United States at the moment, this is less true in Canada, although these same trends are observed in Canada. In the 1950s, Canada and the United States were had some of the lowest levels of economic inequality in the world, particularly the U.S. Now, the United States has some of the highest levels of economic inequality in the world. And so we have gone in the space of half a century in the U.S. From a place where relative advantages and disadvantages were muted to a place where they are apparent, more than apparent, where they are conspicuous. And so I think it's natural that we need to sort of dwell on them now, right? There are suddenly these gaping distances between different social groups in society. And the question is, what do we make of those? Are they debilitating? Are they, a better question is, at what point do those differences turn from desirable to undesirable? Right? So I think these are all, it makes sense these issues are uppermost in our mind.
I read somewhere that when you raised your ideas about David and Goliath to the trustees at the New York Public Library,
yes,
and they all thought of themselves as Davids.
Yeah, so the trustees of the New York Public Library are this is the cream of the crop in New York society. These are the wealthiest, richest, most privileged people that basically on earth. And so I gave a talk on David Goliath and sort of as a, for fun, really, to them, because I thought, let's see what happens. And afterwards, one billionaire after another comes up to me and says that, you know, your discussion of David so resonated with me because I have felt of myself as an underdog. You know, the chopper is hovering outside to take them back to their penthouse. And they can say with a straight face, I have been an underdog. Under which dog is all like, you know, so preposterous. So it does, you know, people's level of delusion when it comes to these categories is quite striking. But
I mean, is it that once a company is successful, it's hard to remain a David? I mean, can you think of, are there those who have managed to remain?
I mean, it is hard. I mean, well, it's hard for the next generation. Right, so in defense of some of these fat cats, they were not born fat. They achieved fatness over the course of their life. But their kids fat from birth. So, you know, these guys, a lot of them, the reason they think of themselves as Davids is that when they started out 40 years ago, some of them were from modest circumstances or 50 years ago. And they made their money, you know, they made their billions the hard way. That seems... Only, by the way, in 2013 can the phrase, they made their billions the hard way, be said with a straight face.
Well, I just to be fair, it's radio and you don't have a straight face.
Yes, that's right, that's right. But their kids... I have a chapter on this very phenomenon in the book, which is that this is this great generational dilemma for rich people, which is that many, many wealthy people grew up in modest circumstances and in the course of growing up modestly learned the lessons that allowed them to become successful. But then their children were denied that, right? Their children who grew up in privilege never learned those lessons. And I sat down at one point with this very, very wealthy guy in Hollywood who described to me this very thing, that he made lots of money thinking he was giving his children an advantage. And now here he was in this palatial house in Bel Air, where the second of his offices was larger than sort of most people's houses. So I didn't even see his main office. We were in the annex to the office. And it was the size of like this arena we're in, this
auditorium
we're in now. But he was saying, you know, he realized belatedly, his kids were now teenagers, that they would never ever learn the most crucial lessons about the value of hard work, the fulfillment you can get from achieving something independently. And they knew nothing about self-reliance. Why? Because every one of their material needs had been provided for. And it's this thing that he had, in one generation, he had both created and destroyed his family's capacity for success, right? It's this paradox that so many successful people confront, that they've denied their children the chance to learn what for themselves the lessons that are necessary for success.
And is it inside some of these present day Goliaths is a little David? I mean, there's their self image is not who they see in the mirror, but who they
still
remember
carry,
do they still have the agility? I know there's these buzzwords, agility, nimbleness. Do they still have that?
In some cases, I'm reminded of this another little trick. You know, sometimes I give these talks to wealthy people, finance guys, and you can mess with their heads a little bit. And the one I did on this very theme, so I would tell them this whole thing about how I had this argument in the book about the inverted U-shaped curve, which is simply a fancy way of saying this very point that I've been making, that if you have no money and I give you some money, you're better off. But past a certain point, when I give you extra money, you're worse off, or at least your children are worse off. So that the relationship between income and your ability to be a good parent is U-shaped. In the beginning, it's easier to be a good parent as I give you money, then it flattens out, and then it becomes harder to be a good parent when you got a lot of money. So you explain this argument to a room full of very, very wealthy hedge fund guys. And then they're used to dealing in numbers. Their whole world is numbers. So you say, and then past a certain point, when I give you extra resources, your kids are worse off. More money means. So there's a kind of hush in the room. And every one of them thinks, oh my God, am I past that point? So you go to Q&A, and first question, guy raises his hand, and he goes, do you have any data on what that point is? What is the... And of course, I don't have any data on this, but here's where you have fun with them. And you go, I do. There is a number that... and you're totally making it up. And so... they want to know the number. And of course, you know, I always say, I think it's $75,000 a year. These guys they've made $75,000 in the previous 5 minutes. Collectively, the color drains from the face. And then I tell them that I don't know what that number is. But it is a kind of moment when you know, it's good, I think, to give them a little kick every now and again. You know, their lives, things go so smoothly at that income level that...
And you could also offer to relieve them of some of their excess...
Yes, I do point out that if they were truly rational actors, they would give away all their money at this point. And that also is a little upsetting.
In terms of overcoming the odds, how do you see the 2008 election of Barack Obama? Would you cast him as a David?
Barack Obama, in 2008. Well, he sort of. I mean, he was running against a deeply unpopular party. And he was... he's an odd figure because he is at once... He seems like an outsider, but then he is the most insidery in some ways. He's a product of the American meritocracy. He's an establishment figure. He went to all the best schools. He knows all the fanciest people. He didn't storm the gates of the upper echelons of American society. He knew all those people. He went to school with them. So he's a kind of, he's an odd mixture of inside and out. So I don't really know how to place him. In a certain way, a woman running for president is much more of an underdog than a black man running for president, particularly when the black man is half African as he is. I would think of Hillary as being much more of a... Hillary Clinton is being much more of an underdog than Obama is.
You said that you feel that each of your books has gotten more engaged with the broader world. Why do you think that is? Or where does David and Goliath fit in terms of the arc of your work?
I don't know. They're more... I think the books have gotten more... the tone is more, the tipping point is concerned, is in some ways a marketing book. I mean, I apply marketing ideas to some social problems, but I'm interested in something that is, that belongs to the world of business, and I sort of play with it in other contexts. This book is about much more kind of fundamental moral questions in some level. It's about the weapons of the spirit. It's about what is the value and power of the things that we carry around in our hearts as opposed to the things that we carry around in our wallets or our hands. So in that sense, there is a kind of progression. I'm interested in, I suppose, bigger questions now than I was in the past. I don't know if that's natural or not. Is that a kind of... Maybe I'll cycle back next time and write something that's very narrow again. There's always a tension, you know, as a writer, between, or at least in my writing, between wanting to write about things that are very, very small and wanting to write things on a grand level. So my favorite New Yorker articles are all articles about very, very small, specific things. You know, the piece I did about why is Heinz ketchup so special? Or
they're just closing their plant in Leamington.
Yes. Well, I should revise it. And
I just thought, how can that be?
Yeah.
Ketchup is so successful.
Yeah. No, no. Are you suggesting that that article was premature? I should go back. I drew a conclusion about Heinz ketchup before pulling
taking
all facts.
Everything
yes,
into
yes.
effect.
No, and then my favorite piece I've ever written is a piece on the Ron Popeil's rotisserie oven, the Showtime rotisserie oven, which I said was the best appliance, greatest appliance, dollar for dollar ever made. You really can't get more narrowly focused than that. I loved that because I loved those notions that you can look at a very, very specific, seemingly trivial thing and let the larger lessons come out naturally, right? But at the same time, I write these books that are about these very grand themes. So I kind of like toggle back and forth. They're between these two modes as a writer.
But you said you've become more religious during the writing of this book.
Well, the writing of this book, yeah, there had an effect on me, which was that, for those who haven't read the book ends with a series of chapters that are about faith. So I'm interested in this book about describing how is it that strength can come from apparent weakness? And the end of the book is about stories of the kinds of strength that come from religious faith. And I found those stories to be... So one of the chapters is about a woman, a Canadian woman, who forgives the murderer. She and her husband forgive the man, the predator, who murdered their teenage daughter, tortured and murdered their teenage daughter. And then the final chapter of the book is about a little town in the mountains of southeastern France during the Second World War of Huguenots who openly take in Jewish refugees. So they don't even bother to hide it from the Nazis. And they defy the Nazis throughout the entire war. And in both those cases, people without any obvious advantages or strengths or authority or resources do something impossibly powerful because of their religious faith. And I had no... In telling those stories, I just was so kind of deeply affected by, in a way that I had not imagined I would ever be, by the notion that faith is powerful in a very tangible way. I got it intellectually, but doing that part of the book brought me back to a notion that there is something extraordinary about what can come out of faith. Because there's nothing else. I don't think there's anything else that can give you the strength to stand up to the Nazis during the Second World War. I don't think you get there just by being... The rational people in France didn't harbor Jewish refugees, right? The people who were, you know... No, it was this crazy town of these Huguenots who had been impossibly persecuted for hundreds of years, who had this deep, unshakable faith in God. They were the ones who took them in, right? They barely had enough food to feed them. And they still did it. And when the French, the Vichy minister, comes to their town, they stand up and give him a letter which says, "We have Jewish refugees. We're hiding them right now, and we just want to tell you that if you come to take them away, we're not going to give them to you." Like, who does that? Right? The answer is people do that when their hearts are filled with the Spirit of God. Right? There's no other... I don't know.
I mean, there were secular people who hid Jews out of a kind of compassion and courage and
sure.
empathy and that. But what you describe here is much more faith-based because it's Huguenot village and it's the minister who leads them and that. So you were raised in a Mennonite
community. No, I was, well, my community. Family in a Mennonite community. So I was, that world is very familiar to me. So it's more a question of writing this book made me appreciate, gave me a kind of powerful appreciation for faith that I had not seen for a long time.
And appreciation or something more internal than that?
More. I honestly think it changed me in a really fundamental way.
Because you had already had on your website that you believe in God, and you said it affects how people perceive you if you have that on your website.
Yeah. Although I think it's weird that people find that an odd thing that someone would say about themselves. But no, that's been, I mean, I would never have shied away from that, from stating that I believe in God. It's a question of, though, it's one thing to formally accept that notion. It's another to feel like you have glimpsed the reason why you accept that notion, right? It's a coming to an understanding of, it's always the why that's the hard part. And there was something about the story of Wilma Dirksen in that book and Andre Trockman, but really it was...
The woman who forgave.
She's the woman in Winnipeg who, she and her husband immediately forgive, not 20 years later, but they stand up when their daughter's body has been found. And the Cliff Dirksen, the father of this 16-year-old girl who's been murdered, the first thing he says when they found her body is that whoever did this, he clearly lacks love in his life. And we'd like to meet him so we can help him, we can bring love in. I mean, that's just extraordinary, right? I mean, and that I don't know, that was, it's very hard, it's not often as, I should take it back. One of the extraordinary things about being a journalist is that you have the opportunity to meet extraordinary people, and more than just meet them, to have them walk you through these moments in their lives that are special. Kind of, you know, it's not, and you can, I don't know, it's a strange and extraordinary profession that lets you do that and see that side of people.
And you feel changed by this? I mean, you think it will inform your writing in some way?
I don't know. It's really impossible to say. You know, it's some sort of everything. I mean, it cannot but on some level. But then, again, writing, the things that you write about as a writer aren't necessarily constituent of who you are, right? You write about, you know, I'm obsessed with track and field. I almost never write about track and field. I'm obsessed with cars.
But you still run. You still run.
Yeah, I still run.
Did you run a 5-minute mile?
I just ran. Well, I ran a 5:02 mile. So I just missed. I just missed 5 minutes. Yeah, it's because I hadn't raced in 35 years, and I had forgotten how to do it. And so I started the race, and I realized I was running. It's in the Fifth Avenue Mile in New York, and so you're in each. Each age group runs in its own little special section. So I'm in my section, and there's like a couple hundred of us, and we take off. And I realize that everyone else is running on the right side of Fifth Avenue, and I'm running all by myself on the left side. And sort of like, you know, bowling alone. There's Malcolm, who has completely forgotten that a race is a social act. It was as if I was like going for a run by myself. It just happened to be a race. And sort of three-quarters of the way through the race, I was like, what are you doing? Why are you running? So I needed to be reminded about what a race is. I think that's next time around. I'm going to kind of.
You were doing the outlier race.
Yes, I'm going to. I am. I'm going to try and play with others next time I race.
You recently turned 50. Was that traumatic?
Thank you for mentioning that, Eleanor. Was it traumatic? Well, you know, I didn't celebrate. I don't let people ever celebrate my birthday. I don't really believe in birthdays. And it almost seemed to me, even as a kid, it seemed like an unearned honor. Like, I didn't get it. Like, I didn't do anything. So, like, one day, randomly, everyone's going to jump up and down. I mean, it's not like it seemed like you should have accomplished something as opposed to just stuck around. And hit a certain day on the calendar, and all of a sudden people are, you know, baking you cakes. Seemed excessive. Still seems excessive.
Are you where you imagined you'd be at this age?
No. My life has not turned out the way that I had imagined, hoped, intended.
Which way did you think it would?
Well, I didn't think that I would become a kind of... I didn't think that there would be a public aspect to my life. I never thought that I would be on stage with Eleanor Wachtel, for example. That seemed to me kind of weird. It still seems to me weird, because I'm not really... my preference was not really to hang out with other people. I'm an introvert. My perfect day is the day that I don't really open my mouth and say anything until after about 7 o'clock in the evening. And I do accomplish that on numerous occasions. Today, I didn't really say much until after seven. It's weird that I should be, in a position where I do this. Do you know what I mean?
And you give some of the most popular TED Talks. I mean, you do a lot of public.
I do. That's why it's weird. I never thought that would. I mean, and introverts are not, the definition of introvert is not someone who is hostile to social interaction. It's simply someone for whom social interaction is costly. So I, at the end of this, will be exhausted and will go home and curl up in a small ball in my hotel room. But if I was Bill Clinton, I would invite all of you to join me, and we would go out. I would be so invigorated, right? That's the difference between introverts and extroverts. I can do this, but then I'm done.
But you're a writer, and that does fit into the lonely profession. The research part involves engaging with other people, but the writing part is a solo, pretty well.
Although
solo
it's funny because writing takes up such a small proportion of my. The amount of time you spend researching and doing the logistics and preparation and stuff for a book dwarfs the amount of time you spend writing the book. It's a strange thing. You think that by becoming a writer you're going to get to write. I write so little that I miss it, and I long for, maybe that's why people write fiction, that you get the ratio there is different. But I spend so much time doing the part that is costly, that is talking to people. Because I really find it really exhausting to interview people.
Even to interview, because that's more listening than talking.
Well, listening to me is one of the most exhausting things. That seriously. People don't... there's this moment in the book where I talk about David Boies, who's a very famous trial lawyer in America who's dyslexic. And his whole thing was, because he couldn't read, he taught himself how to listen. He says being a great trial lawyer is about listening. And he has this whole riff about listening, about how most people don't listen. They really don't. They don't really pay attention to what people are saying. They do it only on a kind of very superficial level. And when you're interviewing someone, I think that you're not really interested in what they're... Or you are interested in what they're saying, but you have to attend to so much more in order to successfully interview. I don't know why I'm telling you this. You're the interviewer. You know what I'm talking about,
right? Talking about.
There's a whole other thing going on. You're taking their pulse the entire time, right? And wondering what's... And you're really interested in their emotional attitude to what they're saying, telling you. That's exhausting. I find it so... And particularly when the person is complicated, it gets even more... exhausting. I used to do things like pretend that my tape recorder had, went back when tape recorders had batteries, as opposed to now. I guess they still do. When they had batteries that ran out, I would always pretend that I had run out of tape and I had to stop. So I could just stop it and start it again at some, so I could recharge. I was really talking about my own personal batteries. Isn't that a great little metaphor? But just because it was so kind of...
If you could do anything, what would you want to be?
Other than a writer, you mean? I wanted to be a real estate developer when I was... and I still sort of do. I think it's kind of... I see buildings and I want to renovate them. You know, I have that kind of impulse. Or I see a hole in the ground and I'm strangely attracted towards it. And they tore down this big hospital that was a block from my house in New York. And you know how four-year-olds are drawn to construction sites, four-year-old boys, in a way that's kind of beautiful, really. I have that same thing. And I had a friend, my friend Charles has a four-year-old, and the whole family went to Israel for the summer, and I found myself sending Charles pictures of the construction site that he could forward to his son, because I felt that we shared this bond. Front-end loaders, you know, concrete being poured, pipes coming out of the ground, the whole thing just was riveting to me. And the idea that there's someone whose job it was to go to that site on a daily basis, that just found me so thrilling. That's always been, it's possibly too late to be I also like how when they get in trouble, they just get bailed out by the banks. That's also fantastic. Like, you know, if you're big enough, you get that happens. They also, you know, developers, I'm sort of going on now, but they're very interesting. You know, they have a thing, because I've always been fascinated by this, it's a cyclical business, right? So the one thing that you are absolutely sure of as a real estate developer is that at some point, if you continue to do what you're doing, you will go bankrupt, right? Because everything always falls apart. And what always happens is some portion of them, you know, in the good times, you borrow tons of money, and you start all these projects, they all take like 6 years, and then the bust happens, it all falls apart, you lose everything, you start over. So the only way for them to be actually successful in that business is to have such a short memory that they don't remember the last time everything went south, right? So there, you talk to them and you realize you're talking to someone who actually does live in the moment. They're the only truly happy people I know. It's a condition of surviving in a highly cyclical universe, right? And you walk them through their history and you say, well, you know, so what happened to you in the crash of 93 or whatever? And they'll say, oh yeah, wiped out, had to start over. And I say, well, so now, what are you doing right now? Oh yeah, I got six buildings going on, every penny, you know, I got into the banks to a couple hundred million. What will happen if things fall apart? Oh, they're not going to fall apart. Oh, really? They're not going to fall apart, right? It's like, it's fabulous. It's like, there's a kind of, they're so liberated. I feel they should give seminars to the rest of us on how to live their lives.
I have a last question. Why do you like spy novels and mysteries?
Why? Because I suppose I like, I don't know. I say this because even as I spent a portion of this afternoon on various websites looking at lists of top spy novels, I literally did this afternoon, top 100 spy novels of all time, and I would go down and see, have I missed any? I mean, and then I had my iPad, and I was downloading the ones that I've missed. Why do I like them so much? Well, I like the fact that I know all the tropes. So I know all the moves, right? I can sort of see what's coming. And when someone I'm so deeply into the genre that when someone does even the slightest twist, I know, oh, that's fantastic. They kind of, and also I'm reading one right now called The Mole. I don't know why, because if it's got mole, spy, whatever in the title, I will buy it. And the guy makes a mistake, I think, in like the second chapter. And I'm outraged. I'm like, I want to write him a letter. It's like, why did you tell me that the guy's a mole in chapter 2? Why didn't you wait till chapter 6? It makes way more sense. So I'm so kind of, there's a special kind of pleasure that comes from being, like, it's like, you ever talk to someone who really knows a lot about tennis? When they watch Wimbledon or some tennis match, their experience of watching it is so different from yours. And so much more fascinating and nuanced, and they'll say, did you see the something, something, something? And you're like, of course not. And they're like, that shot was sick. Unbelievable. And you're like, just look to you like someone hit it back. So it's like, and you realize that there's a beauty in being in really deep, right? Well, I'm that way with spy novels. When I read a spy novel, I'm at a whole nother level.
Well, it's no mystery about why you're so successful. I just want to thank you. It's a great pleasure to talk to you again. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Ah, right. Short question and answer. Short questions, longer answers. You can go to the mic, or if you shout out, I'll repeat the question.
Set it and forget it.
Oh. That was a reference to my article on the Showtime Rotisserie Oven. The guy who was invented it, Ron Papil, was the one who famously coined the phrase, set it and forget it.
Oh, set it. I thought he said seven.
Yes, which
set
is
it and forget it.
Something, those are words to live by.
Question at that, Mike?
Yes, hello. Mr. Gladwell, what I like about you is that you look at different fields of research and you make connections. That's one of the reasons I like you. But I was wondering, because you have a broad view of things, if you're in charge of funding all the research going on in the world right now, I don't have the power to make that happen, but let's just say. Is there an area of research, whether it's medicine, new energy, education, what have you, that you feel is particularly neglected, that we should be really sinking a lot more energy, resources, money, cultural attention on, that's just not getting the credit it deserves?
Ha. Huh. That's one interesting question. I don't know if I have a good answer to that. I think that I'm not saying anything that's particularly new here, but the stuff that really excites me the most is anything interdisciplinary. So I love it. I'm very interested in healthcare and follow all kinds of healthcare stuff. I love it when people from outside healthcare think about healthcare. I wish there was, if I was magically funding stuff, I would fund far more of that kind of cross-pollination. I would love the idea to get way more engineers to sit in on operations and to walk around hospitals. And that's sort of starting to happen in really interesting ways. But that kind of stuff is the stuff that really excites me, when you can get fresh perspectives on things.
Thank you.
I teach tourism marketing at a community college here in Montreal, and when I read The Tipping Point, I was flabbergasted. There are hundreds of terrific marketing examples in the book, and I was wondering if after you wrote it and you talked to anybody, did they adapt anything that you explained in the book specifically to tourism marketing?
Oh, I don't know. You know, I have this problem that when I write a book, I promptly lose interest in it. And so once that book was over, I kind of had moved on. It's a defensive thing because you have two options when you write a book. If you write a book, then it attracts all kinds of attention, some of it negative. If you are deeply invested in the book, then you have to be prepared to shoulder the pain of all that potentially negative attention. The other option is, so that's one way. You can care and suffer. The other option is not to care and not suffer. So I adopt the not care posture. And so when someone attacks my book, I always say, I agree. I think that book is flawed too. So I've walked away from that and all other of my books. So I can't tell you what someone has done with it, I'm afraid.
Good evening. My question has to do with Canada. In polls, I think we've learned that about at least 80% of Canadians are very concerned about global warming, but Canadians somehow elected a majority government that ignores global warming. And could you please try and comment on that? And is there a David somewhere in the wings?
Oh, dear. I'm going to give a glib answer because I don't have a better one. I think that, actually, it's not glib. It's a serious answer. I think that it's not a practical answer. How's that? It has struck me in both the United States and in Canada and also throughout Europe that increasingly the national boundaries of countries are proving to be a hindrance to effective government and not a help. The problem with global warming in Canada is that the interests of the petro economies within Canada are at odds with the interests of the rest of the country. What is in the interest of Alberta is not necessarily in the interest of people in Ontario when it comes to something like global warming, right? Similarly, in the United States, you could make the same argument about immigration. What is in the interest of New York State is not necessarily in the interest of other states that are more conservative. These large federations of geographically and culturally distinct areas that we put together in the 19th and 18th century for other reasons, for military reasons, for practical reasons, for what have you, maybe they're no longer relevant anymore. And maybe we shouldn't feel badly about breaking Canada up into four parts or the United States up into five parts and allowing people to have governments that more closely reflect their interests. Right? The kind of America, I live in New York, the kind of America that New Yorkers want to see has very little in common with the kind of America that many Texans want to see. And that's not because New Yorkers are right and Texans are wrong. It's just because we're different. So why force people who have very different interests to occupy the same... I think America is greatly improved by being broken up into three pieces. And maybe the same is true of Canada. You know? I don't know. Is that... It's impractical, but I don't think it's flippant, that suggestion. Toronto might want to break off Mississauga into a separate...
I know earlier you talked about, it was just like a side comment, how you think that Hillary Clinton might be more of an underdog than Barack Obama, or at least in the context of the 2008 election. Could you kind of expand on that? Or
no, I'm more... I have for the longest time been... I was thinking of writing something on this. I've been really struck by how slowly the passage of women into electoral politics has been. And even more striking to me is if you make a list of all the countries that have had a female head of state, the overwhelming majority of them have only had one female head of state. In other words, they have one, and then they say, we're done, and that's it. And I find that really weird. And it suggests to me, in America, I think it was easier for people to elect a black man than it is for them to elect a woman. In many ways, gender politics lag behind even racial politics in many parts of the West. And I find that very puzzling and disturbing in some sense. So that's why I think, you know, I think Obama got a lot of additional friction because of his race. But I think it pales in comparison to the kind of friction and that Hillary Clinton would encounter if she became a viable candidate for president. I just think it's going to be like a firestorm. You have no idea. Like, look at what happened in Australia with Julia Gillard. Unbelievable. You know, a perfectly competent, good politician who happens to be a woman gets treated in a way that was appalling during her time in office. If you think it's going to be any different for an American woman, you're crazy. So that's why it's an odd thing. I don't know why there's a certain sense in which I think gender politics are remain this extremely problematic part of the political world.
Thanks.
Last question.
Yes. So you express the point of view of somebody being with nothing to lose, like, but you outline it mainly in a positive light, at least during this session here. And you're talking also about the power of religion, but putting those two together, when I see all those people that are that have very, very strong belief and have nothing to lose and want to make a statement, it sounds like a very scary situation.
Yeah, you know, the thing you have to understand about the role of the underdog is that it is, you can use the various weapons available to the underdog can be used for good or ill. So I chose to highlight in my book examples of people who I think use those things for positive ends. But you are absolutely right that there is a flip side to that, and that terrorists have weapons of the spirit and have nothing to lose. And so it really, you know, the Tea Party in America behaved like classic underdogs when they shut down the government for 3 weeks. So these are double-edged swords, absolutely. And I don't think we can is an important complicating fact. It so happens that I am more impressed by the positive use of those things than the negative use, but it's absolutely the case that the opposite is true.
Okay.
Eleanor, Malcolm, as Dean of the Faculty of Arts, I want to thank both of you on behalf of McGill University, the faculty, the McGill Institute for the Study of Canada, and the entire audience for a wonderful evening. We've all learned a great deal and have been entertained. And once again, thank you. I have a small token of our appreciation for you. I just have to remember which one has the Rob Ford bobblehead doll in it. So.
And just to a final announcement, Malcolm Gladwell will now kindly be holding a book signing on stage. The McGill Bookstore has made David and Goliath available at a specially reduced price today, and they're selling books just outside the main entrance if you still need to pick one up. If you'd like to have your book signed, please line up like the good, polite New Yorker readers you are in the two center aisles here, and the ushers at the front will help direct you to Mr. Gladwell.